Hey, hey, Cameron Wilson, good to see you. Thanks for joining. Cool. Toiler! Hello! Thanks for joining, thanks for being here. We're just doing some street art today. Just doing some... Yo, yes, yes, yes. Good to see you, Ux. Thanks for your order. I'm gonna sign it on the... I'll sign it real quick here, actually. Once we get a few more people, if that works for you. So cool. Yeah, actually, your order had me pull back up that the Nemesis Magician Death Battle article. I thought that was really interesting. It was originally shared with me by Electropunk TTV, and yeah, it's cool. Especially having worked with Death Battle last year, it's definitely something that I would totally be up for and want to see done. Let me pull my House of the Dead goodies out. Oh, you wrote it? I saw it was post. The copy I saw was posted by a user, Otto. I didn't know that you wrote it. That's amazing. It's so well constructed. Yeah, it's good. It's a very, very strong argument. I saw the trailer, too. The trailer's cool. Mm-mm-mm. Oh, great. The magician piece is here. I have these blood red envelopes that I'll mail it to you with. Ten years? I'll have to talk to someone. Maybe I could talk to someone and see what we can do. No promises, but it seems like something that would be right up their alley. Halia. We're playing the Lords of the Fallen soundtrack. It's made by, or conducted and composed by Chris Velasco, who did God of War, I think Resident Evil Village, just a ton of things, super decorated. It's a really good soundtrack. I pre-ordered the vinyl too. I'm excited. That's coming out. Shoot, I think that's coming out like in like a month or two. I'll have to do a unboxing for it. When they did the House of the Dead vinyl, the company recognized my order and wrote us a really sweet personalized letter to me, and I put that on, not the letter, but I put the unboxing, discovering the letter on TikTok. That was really cool. That was really cool. I'm excited for the Lord's vinyl. It's gonna be great. Where'd my stamps go? Who can say? It's a problem for another day. What's on my board, Leah? So this is Disney World just celebrated their 50th. So this is the Donald, because Donald's my favorite. Pull him up here. Don, my favorite. And pictures of my dear ones. There's I'll pull this off too. That's my favorite part. really good. This is like kind of like this is sort of like a D&D patch.
A Dungeons and Dragons patch.
And then this is one of my favorite patches. This is Arthur is Thanos. I got this at, since we live in Orlando, I got this at the at Krampus Fest, which is like every first week of December every year. And I mean, it's self-explanatory, but there's like local artisans, and I love Thanos Arthur. I think it's just so funny. So yeah, just like a bunch of patches I enjoy. And then there's this parody company called Paperback Paradise. And they do these like really thorough fake covers of stuff. I don't know if Instagram Live has community guidelines. I'm new here, but like stuff like this that are like these like pulpy kind of like old 60s novels that are super funny. Paperback Paradise on Twitter. So I have a collection of their stuff, and I like to put it up without comment, just so people can discover it for themselves. So yeah, that's what's going on. I initially was trying to get the mics out of the shop, and I was like, oh, the mics are a part of it, I suppose. And then the wallpaper is Spoonflower. I really love their stuff. I'm thinking of getting a little fake torch that blows in the wind and has like the light up in the fabric. And then I want to put some vintage burlap prints of different postcards from the 60s on the panels. That's the studio. Yeah, Thanos Arthur is honestly the star of the show today. Cool. Let's get some signing going. We'll start with my friend Uix, who we were talking earlier about the prospect of having Nemesis from Resident Evil and Magician on Death Battle, and I was on Death Battle last season. So I know the guys, and would love to get something together with that. It's been anticipated. It's been desired. So we'll get one of these crispy Magician postcards. Thank you so much, Uix. I really appreciate it. It was very fun to play Adam. I found, and you can find this on Reddit, I found this last night because I was just like, I don't know, I was looking up a blog article that I was trying to share with someone, and I found this Reddit about the Adam voice, and they said, Electro's art is amazing. This is Electropunk TTV. Electropunk is currently getting a degree in graphic design, but if you ask me, I think Electro knows just all the stuff that he needs to know. He's amazing. Yeah, this is his magic, minimalist magic. I love it. What was he talking about? Oh, and the Reddit was talking about the Adam voice and how it reminded them of Chris Parnell. And I was like, I have always felt like a kinship with Chris Parnell's voice. He's the voice of Jerry on Rick and Morty. He's also the voice of the TurboTax. No, I don't think it's the one where it's the book. It might be TurboTax, the talking book. And he is Dr. Spichemin on 30 Rock. I like that he talks like a newsman. I think that he has a great, voice. And then everyone's like, I can't unhear Jerry. I was like, but also, you know, Chris Parnell does a few other things. He's also an archer. Cool. Uix, did you want... I usually do copper with Magician. Do you want copper? Or do you want silver? Hey, Cody, good to see you, buddy. Copper, you got it. Let's fire it up. And I assume you want the Nemesis versus Magician, hashtag Nemesis versus Magician on the front, like maybe at the bottom nicely, or do you want it on the back? Cody being cheeky.
Being cheeky.
Mmm. The soundtrack. Giving a little John Williams, Harry Potter. On the front. Of course it's fine. Of course it's fine. All right, let's get this sign right.
Nice. Put it on the drying pile.
Great. What's cool is if you store this in a place where it catches the light. Yeah, okay. All right. All right. Good start. Yeah. Pops. I like that. Thank you again, UX. I really appreciate
your investment,
your mutual investment in the character. I really like Magician. It was a really big privilege to play Final Boss, as it said in the audition. Cool. Let's get some Dunmise flowing here. We got a gloss on him. He loves a ring light. So I'll talk for a sec about this design, because I'm signing these, of course, like you can order through my link on my page, but I'm also signing these for Streamly's backstock, so we'll be signing these all morning. So for this design, I worked with Joel DeCue on it. So Joel DeCue is from Powerhouse, who does Castlevania. He is a character designer over there, and I really wanted it to feel like a painting or something from the world of the game. Let me get it at the right angle so he's not washed out by the giant ring light I have here, colossal. Let me turn down the ring light a sec, just a tick. And I also want it to be inspired by, like, Russian religious icons, so that's why he has, like, the seraphim along the hat, and, of course, the umbral lamp here. It's a really beautiful piece. I was just so, I love the texturing up here with, like, the watercolor. I was just overjoyed how it came out, and Joel is just amazing. You should check out Joel DeCue Art. So it's JoelDeCue Art on Instagram. He's, or maybe JDQ Art. You can look him up. He's fabulous. Yeah, I love like the stream of light too, washing through the base of the. Yeah, the texture is really cool. He's just like has an amazing costume. We saw that from the first gameplay trailer. With the three captains. His art and his like cloaks, like so many cloaks, so many layers of fabric and everything. I felt like it was so evocative of all the secrets that he, contains. Hey Josh, thanks for joining, sir. All right, let's get our first Dunmeyer just signed just so we can get a drying. Quah, quah, quah. I'm nervous. Let me get a little, make sure the ink is just right. Cool. All right, let's do it. I'm happy with that. I think placement is something I would like to consider. Because you want the... I don't know, I'm new here. I think you want the signature to be, like, clearly visible, but also not obstruct the art. I don't know, what do we think about this? So in the light, you catch it, but out of the light, you get an unobstructed view of the... I'd probably put it lower on my next one. In light we walk, you know what I mean? Yeah. I like this a lot.
I like it!
Whilst we're doing stock, I should do... I'll do a couple Rogans as well. I heard this music, I was like, is Baldur's Gate playing? What's going on here? I like to do the Silves for Rogan. First signing. Yeah, my first autograph was, maybe it was last year. I think it was last year. And I got an email from someone, and I didn't have any prints at the time because I didn't really have any characters that I felt were like print worthy. I got an email, and they're just requesting signature, and I was like, I don't have anything to sign. CAUX, thank you so much, buddy. I'll get this mailed out to you today or tomorrow. Express, thank you again for your support. Appreciate it. hey Santo, good to see you, buddy. So Leah, the first signature, yeah, it was an email last year, and I didn't have anything to sign, and they were like, it's fine, you can sign like a note card. And so I signed a note card and I mailed it to them, and I was so like, you know, it's just so unprecedented that I just like didn't even think to ask. And then eventually I was like, what is this for again? They were like, they were talking about Cloud Punk, which is a game I did. Oh, probably did Cloud Punk in 2020. And it's a huge cast. And you can see on IMDb, like, everyone's in that game. They were like, oh, yeah, I'm just collecting all of the signatures from the game, which is... That's really dope. And I think people underestimate the power of just like cold contacting someone, sending them an email. You know, I met Santo through Electropunk, and I met Electropunk through a cold email. Electropunk was like, I'm not asking for anything. I'm just wanted to, you know, tip my cap, you know, enjoyed the games, enjoyed the House of the Dead games. And then we got to talking, and Electropunk invited me into the House of the Dead speedrunning community, where I met Santo, and Electropunk is a good friend to Santo, and just seems like a good friend in general, because immediately he was like, oh, we gotta get Santo in on this. And I was like, okay, cool. And we created a little Discord server, and I ended up guesting on Electro's Week of the Dead stream, and then I got to guest on Santo's stream, and then later in the year, Santo and I got to do the, or I was invited into Santo's run of on Games Done Quick, which is like the name in speedrunning. So that was really cool. Glad to have you here, Santo. All right, cool. Let's do a magician. Nice crispy magician.
Yeah.
All these great questions, Leah. How are you thinking of all these great questions? A franchise that I'd like to be a part of. They just announced Red Dead Redemption 3 over at Rockstar, and I would really, really, really love to be in that game. I remember the first teaser from Red Dead Redemption 2, where they're sitting around the fire, and it's a cold open, and he says, I saw your name in our ledger. And then it's just an adventure from there on out. I'm a big Westerns fan growing up in Arizona, so yeah, it would just be everything, especially like the performance capture element. That's very much a big endeavor of mine to do that, because coming from the theater, it feels like such an expansion of the theater's ability to storytell. And with what I love about voice acting is that you can be anything that you want, you know, across a lot of lines where people would discount you, where people would have perhaps like a judgment of how you appeared or how you presented, or, you know, A, B, and C that come with, you know, on camera or theatrical acting. You can be more, I feel, in those roles. They're more accessible. And to me, performance capture, from what I know of it and what I've studied of it, is in that same vein, where it's like, you know, this like water bottle that's green, you know, with these dots on it, can be an 800-pound club for your character. You know, these different things that really expand your capacity as a storyteller. And to combine that with my love of Westerns would be just an absolute dream. We'll see. I've enjoyed going out for Rockstar stuff in the past. I think they're awesome. So it's not out of the realm of possibilities. Hello, Mr. Dimolo, if that is your real name. No, I was kidding. Welcome. Thanks for joining. Let's get another piece signed here. Let's do Magish. I love this. I'll never get over the metallics catching the light, and they dry so quickly. Everyone should use copper markers. That's my hot take. Oh, good questions of you, Doc. Thank you. But what would challenge me? Physically, what would challenge me? Like, as far as like vocal ability, I feel like doing something in the world of Dragon Ball you know, or Baki, the anime, or like a fighting anime, magic casting anime. All the anime I've done thus far has been like sports, which is still, you know, pretty physical, but not like fighting for your life sort of situation. And slice of life anime. So I would love to expand into something like Black Clover or, you know, the world of Chainsaw Man, stuff like that. I think Chainsaw Man especially would be, they're psychologically and like physically challenging roles. So I would love to take a swing at something like that. In video game world, I think something that was performance capture that was like fairly physical, I think would be, challenging, but very welcome at this juncture in my work. I would love to do something like that. Maybe a character that's like, fighting zombies or something, or a character that's fighting robots or something, you know, like jumping around and shooting and doing dialogue and scenes like that. Yeah, any of that stuff that would engage the movement aspect, I think would also be really challenging. I can imagine myself being challenged by a lot of things. I don't know really what that reflects. I'll think about that. Heroes or villains? Good question. I mean, I just never get to voice heroes. Like but I like villains. I was always really uncomfortable. My least favorite thing was even stepping in momentarily for ingenues. I don't like ingenues. I don't like characters that are like motivated by being in love. It's not really my thing. I guess villains, yeah. I read a thing for a villain, it was a couple days ago, and I looked up insert this character, like what's their deal. I looked that up on Google because I was like, what, why is the public opinion this way about this kid? It's like an ancient character, and yeah, because I have so much love for sure. I was looking up this ancient villain character, and I was like, what's their deal? And Google explained why people felt this way about this character, and I was like, that doesn't seem like a bad thing, you know? And this isn't like a historical, real-life person. It's a fictional ancient character, but I was like, I can't really see the problem here. So maybe that's a sign I've been doing them too long. But yeah, just always villains. I've just always been doing them. I feel like I have a lot of empathy for their motives, but I can also at the same time appreciate, you know, why their behavior is antisocial or is... you know, in counterpoint to how society needs to work. I'm teaching actually my final session for this cohort at closing credits tonight, game mode, where we do voice acting for video games. Humble plug. And always be closing. And it's the final class is villains, is what the final 2-hour block is. So we go through villain. I created that class last year, maybe a year before, and it was animation and video game villains, and then I made it just video game villains for closing credits. And we talk a lot about character psychology, and you'd be amazed how many people, I don't know, maybe it's a good thing. Not that I'm about to say it. Maybe it's a good thing, but like there's so many people that are just uncomfortable with their inner darkness, right? They're uncomfortable with like what they're capable of, what other people are capable of. They struggle to, I think that they're nervous to identify with a villain. I think, and that makes sense, you know, we're like conditioned not to. And I think in a lot of respects, don't get me wrong, in a lot of respects, you know, villains are villains for a reason. You know, they are antisocial. Their goals are in counterpoint to society's progress. So it's important that we compartmentalize them for sure. But then, you know, I think that understanding their motives doesn't put you in danger of becoming a villain or enacting. Having an understanding of why the Joker works the way he does, I don't think puts you in danger of becoming the Joker. You know what I mean? Oh, hello, Cousin Bella. Thank you so much for joining. And thanks for the heart. Ice cream, so good. God, I'm no better than Ethan Slater at all. What a horrifying thought. Let's sign something. Let's put a little smack roll on this. Probably get a sign. The last one I did across the chest here, I'm probably, since there's a lot of action going on there, I might send it across here. I think that that's the natural place to do it. What do you guys think?
Oh, they glossy.
I'm thinking of getting some holographic ones in the future if people express interest. Might also get some Fire Emblem ones.
The yays have it.
I'm gonna do. I just went into a fugue state, deciding what pen to use. I have this great candy apple green that the artist who created the House of the Dead ones had me sign a copy of House of the Dead and send it off to where he lives. And I like to use the red ones for the backs of the House of the Dead postcards. I think I might use this Lords of the Fallen blue. It's the Umbral blue. It's a fine tip pen. I'm just thinking. Yeah, let's go for it. Let's go for it. Let's see what magic can be done.
What can be done in the face of such reckless hate?
I butchered that. All right. It's subtle. I'm thinking. I'm forming an artistic opinion. It might be too subtle. You see it? I may have to go over this with silver or something. I'm gonna put it on my desk here and think about it. Good question. Games I'm excited to play. Something that came out recently that I'm interested in, it didn't hook me in immediately, but my brother-in-law really loves it, is The Finals. I think that's a pretty fun game. Cool concept. I imagine in a couple seasons it'll be really cooking. Games I'm excited to play. I'm excited to watch other people play Persona next week. I'm not great at JRPGs at the moment. I could learn. But I'm excited for other people's excitement for playing that game. Judas. Yeah, want to play Judas from the BioShock people. That one, if you haven't seen that, you're playing Persona 3? Cool. Oh, is Persona 3 Reloaded is out? Did they do an early, is that the, or the original Persona 3? Watches chat very, very observantly. Yo, I won't tell. Good stuff. Are you digging it? The remastered stuff looks really gorgeous, and I love that cast. They're just such a collection of great people. Yeah, I gotta get into these Persona games.
The kids are going on about.
I really want to play Judas, though. If you look up the Judas announcement trailer, great. I hear that about. I know someone who Persona 5 is their favorite game, and they like had they were like newer to the series. So, all right, I'll bite. I'm excited for Judas. If you watch the announcement trailer, it has Lever, Johnny Lever from the sea shanty, and it's you. You're basically escaping this sinking, crashing spaceship. But all the art, down to the character movement, because I'm sure they use the same engine, all that stuff, is so just classically BioShock. And yeah, BioShock is just, in my opinion, the best there is. Good stuff. Let me... double over this with silver. I think this helps it. At least draws the eye to the SIG. So you have that umbral blue going. This ring light is killing me. It's killing my ass. You know, umbral blue, it's more subtle, and then we just have like a couple artful, tasteful dashes. Put this on the drying rack over here.
So much paper, so little desk.
Hey, welcome. FGC Gabe.
Let's get down my side. Welcome, welcome, friends.
I realize it's if there's any West Coast people here, I know it's pretty early on the West Coast for future signings. I'll probably do them in the early afternoon. I just had a couple things this afternoon. Ugh. Right, you caught the Judas trailer? Yeah, I think I saw it. I don't know where I saw it, but it definitely just... I was a little kid again, sitting at the TV just glued to it. Like, it really connected with me. Love these copper pens. They make everything so much nicer. All right, I'll put this over here. Good stuff. Let me change up the music here. I love the Lords of the Fallen soundtrack, but it can get kind of heavy, of course, naturally. It's Mornstead, after all. Let's do the House of the Dead soundtrack. Yeah, I can talk about my studio setup one second here. So, I'm... All right, let me pause one thing before starting another. And that's on ADHD. So I can't necessarily move the camera because I'm nervous that I'll ruin it, the shot. But I have 13 of these 2-foot by 4-foot fiberglass panels that are wrapped in burlap. And when I was learning acoustics, the rule of thumb was like 75% of your wall should be covered in sound treatment. You don't want to cover it too much, because it'll just suck the sound. It'll make it sound really unnecessarily dead. So I have panels on the walls and the ceiling, and it's carpeted in here. It's my first studio that's been carpeted. My previous ones, I had to put big old thick rugs down. And when you're looking at acoustics, to avoid it getting boxy, you also have to be mindful of this concept of standing waves. So every time we talk, the sound goes vertically and also horizontally and also forward to back. So on the X, Y, and Z axes, a lot of people tend to pad right behind the microphone, or like they have like a mud guard up behind the microphone. They don't treat anything behind them, but really all of the bounce is coming from behind your head. So I have a couple of, you know, again, these huge panels. Behind me, up here, underneath what was once a shelf in this walk-in closet, are bass traps. So those are different density foam to suck up, you know, those lower resonances that collect in corners and add to boxiness. And then I think it's important to pick the right microphones for your space. So, like, I have a Neumann TLM-103 here, which is what... You know, it's just kind of like a standard in video game and in anime and all that stuff. So I got that kind of just in time to start doing anime in 2021. Or maybe it was 2022. I don't know. The years. The years between 2020 and 2024 are such a blur. And then I have this Sennheiser MKH-416 here. So this is actually a shotgun mic designed for film that, I think it was created in like the 70s, and they basically just like found a winning combination and have been manufacturing this specific microphone. It could benefit from a little bit of air, a little bit of wind. This specific microphone for 50 years, 40 years. And this is really good for lower voices, directional pickup, right? It rejects all the stuff outside of this shotgun directional thing and directional pickup pattern. And it's really good for like trailers and promos. So when I get to do stuff for like UFC, because we did the Dalidze fight promo yesterday, for next week, and getting to do stuff for ESPN and Monday Night Football, I'll work on that mic. Versus if I'm doing character stuff, it's gonna come up on this mic. But if I had gotten an even nicer in the next tier, like a Neumann UA87, I think it would be a little bit too sensitive for this booth, because that thing can just hear stuff down the street. And I think a lot of people, when they're setting up their booths, are getting equipment that is that exposes the booth's weaknesses on accident. Like, they'll get a really nice microphone and then be using like 49ers blankets, you know, to coat the thing. And blankets are great, but you know, you have to have the right density. So yeah, and that's on the booth. Thank you for asking. I appreciate your participation. Cool. Wait a second here. I thought this was a stack of magicians, but it's all Rogans. Let me get my magician prints out. I'll do a couple Rogans.
do. Noise.
Nobody gives me instructions.
The Cardinal's blankets are heavy with shame. Yeah, heavy with shame and all of the expectations of people that are just doomed to be disappointed. Just laid in on them. Go Cards.
All right, let me...
Trying to stay on top of allowing the markers to dry management. Radio theater work. Yeah, I actually do. So like scripted podcast. I got an email. I'm on Birds of Empire season 2. And that's created by Jason Liu from, he's one of the writers for Insecure. And of course he has so many other credits. Very decorated guy. Very just wonderful director too. Sweet man. He created Birds of Empire, which is like this mythical, giant, like expansive mythical world. And I think it was already slated for or purchased for like 4 or 5 seasons on Q Code. And I got to be a part of season 1, and I had a character come back for season 2. And Jason also wrote a character for me for season 2, and that was just an honor to play the character Thorn. I admittedly am a couple episodes behind, but Thorn is already like on the scene in this show. He's in 3 episodes of it. The new season's almost actually fully out, Leah. You'd like it a lot. It's good. It's cool. There's so much vision to it. You know, it's mixed by Christopher Nolan's sound designer. So it has the binaural audio. The soundtrack's amazing. They added art to it this year. So all the different episodes have like a symbolic imagery around it. And they've created a visual language for the show. I could see it getting picked up for a series. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if it goes to television, because also Jason's writing is just so lyrical and beautiful. So Birds of Empire is the current scripted that I have coming out, and I'm always looking for that next one, because I really love scripted podcast ever since. Did you see, have you heard Black Friday? Did I put you on to Black Friday with Fred Armisen? While you're thinking about that, I'll get another signing going on. Yeah, Black Friday, yeah. Black Friday was so fun. Yeah, so those are my 2 favorite ones I've done. If you haven't heard, if you look up The Dark on Spotify, The Dark Columbia Play Festival, we did that in 2021, I think. Maybe 2023. It's an amazing piece about escaping civil war in Africa and immigrating to the UK, and it's a true story based on, you know, his life. The playwright, and The Dark is a very special, dear piece to me. I play 3 characters in that, that's a really good scripted podcast. Cool. Ooh. I'll be on like another 30 or so. Then I'll start getting this stuff packaged up. Got to mail it out. a good track. Do a couple green. Candy apple up there.
fun with Kate.
Thank you for the question, Lee. I do. Right now I'm big on to SOVT stuff, so semi-occluded vocal track, which you probably know about. It's phonating into a straw. Sometimes people do this into water. I don't do it. Into water. I like to do it into the into the microphone, just so I can monitor what's actually going on with the chords. I think it's really cool because you can hear without any sort of interruption, you know, no articulators, anything, what's going on with the chords. But yeah, I like to do like vocal eases, like dog growls, or like, you know, engine starts really low, and then puppy dog whines really high, and then connecting the attic to the basement, so to speak, on those. Maybe some light sirens on that. Gotta make sure like the articulators are warmed up, but honestly, I feel like if I over warm up the articulators, then it gets kind of theatrical, the stuff, you know? A little bit of sleepiness sometimes does a performance good. So, with the articulation specifically. I do that pretty much every morning if I can. And I also really love vocal mist. Do you know about the vocal mist, the saline vocal mist stuff? I don't think we've talked about that before. It's really good. It's like a nebulizer with saline. And you know, like, how hard it is to hydrate the chords. Like, it just goes straight to them, you know? So, I'm a big fan of the vocal mist. That's my real secret weapon these days, especially for recovery for stuff. You know, you have a screamy session or something, and you have to do... Yeah, you just got the vocal mist? Yeah. You're gonna love it. Is it getting shipped out to where you're working, or is it going to New York? Or you probably bought one like a couple months ago. Really? Cool. Awesome. I hope they're super legit and good. Yeah, that stuff will save you. It's really good. It's so good. I'm dreaming about doing it right now, actually. For no reason. Ah! That's funny. It will break in 2 to 3 months. I'd be interested to see, like, is it the brand Vocal Mist or is it a nebulizer? For the soundtrack. Okay, cool. Yeah, I mean, no, there's not. I just wasn't sure if they were selling Vocal Mist like on the streets out there. Everyone turning down for this in the club. Something that happens on mine is that it will appear that it's broken, but it's really a salt buildup on the connectors, which is like a weird, honestly, design flaw. There's these three metal connectors, these three metal conductors at the base of the compartment that connects to the charger or to the electrical thing. That sometimes has like saline buildup or salt buildup, and then it's not giving, you know, as much power and connection to it. Hey Ethan, thanks for dropping in, brother, man. We're coming up right on the end of our time here, but it's good to see you. Signing these sweet pieces. Lords of the Fallen. Let's do a couple more House of the Deads for backstock here. Yo. Isn't the green cool? It's this candy apple sort of like, yeah, like, it's really good. It's cool for House of the Dead, because in Germany and other places where there was like censorship, maybe even Japan, they converted all the blood to bright green. So you're seeing like green spatter, that color, all over the screen all the time. And with the remake on all consoles, you can change all the colors. You can do rainbow, you can do any color. Lots of fun. Lots of fun. Let's do a magician with green. Yeah. It's really cool, and it dries so quick. It's good stuff. I honestly would sign everything this color if it wouldn't annoy people. I like it. I'm transfixed by it. I'm staring into its umbral depths. Thank you. Hey, Mr. Jackson, thanks for joining, sir. Look at that. The silver just really offsets it nicely. Since these are, this is the debut of this print, I'm not 100% figured out on where we want to sign it, right? You don't want to spoil this like really cool light trail here, light tracing that Jill DeCue did. But you also don't want to ruin this beautiful, iconography up here. So we're experimenting, trying some stuff out. If you get a copy and you're like, I don't like where this is signed, you know where to find me. I'll make it right. Got 4 left to sign, and then we'll be off. So we'll probably be on like another 10 minutes or so. As far as merch is concerned, something interesting, there's not like a lot of like fan-made stuff for Dunmire, but someone created a 3D map of his, ooh, that's a good idea. That's a really good idea, Civity Ox. Yeah, I'll do that. I'll do one like that. Someone recreated Dunmire's cane. Like 3D print, they'll 3D print it for you on Etsy. I thought that was really interesting. I don't think they have any copyright strikes against them because it's so specific. Yeah, you can get the 3D print of his cane. Honestly, I might do it. That's like actually pretty cool. Now that I mention it, I think it might be half scale, because his cane in the game is like kind of like a staff. Yeah, I thought that was interesting. In my adventures trolling the internet to see how people are reacting to a character, sometimes you encounter really interesting stuff. Let's do a Rogan. I'm gonna start doing these Rogans with green just because I like it. Sideways along the right hand side. Okay, I'll do that next. Come on, this soundtrack rips. Yeah, I'm in love with the candy apple green now. I might do magicians in copper and Rogans in green from here on out, but I like mixing it up. If people don't specify, kind of like trading cards or something. Let's compare them. Let us compare them. I usually do the Rogans. And I'm really liking, I don't know, what do you guys like better? Or do you think that I should keep doing them different? I don't know. I'm torn. I'll never get over how quick that stuff dries. Green. Thank you. Green it is. Thanks so much, Ethan. I'm glad you played it, dude. Did you play it? You chuck it out? Oh. Green! right, we'll do one more Rogan Green, and then we'll do a Dunmire Silver right side vertical like Civity Doc said. I love it. Yeah, yeah, same here, actually. Same here. I've done a surface level of a bunch of classes through the first few zones. Like, looking at their inventory and, you know, their fight styles and stuff. But, yeah, it's definitely got the staying power, that great depth to it. And they're adding really cool community events all the time. Just had a big update push. They do holiday stuff. It's a wonderful team. It's a real privilege to get to be a part of the story. Yeah, guys, I really like this green. This green has carried me away. All right, we got four more Dunmoys. Oh, so Civity Doc, you're saying put it on this side. I like that. I don't know why I never hear this part of the soundtrack. I'm always just panic shooting. And we're listening to House of the Dead Remake. Thank you so much, brother, man. Really appreciate the support. It the atmosphere, the art direction, it got nominated for art direction in a few different awards categories. The Mornstead energy is really cool. I think the switching back and forth between Umbral and Axiom, I think is a really cool trope as well. Helps set it apart in the Souls-like genre. Hey, Mr. Hudson, good to see you, buddy. Thanks for dropping in. We just have a few more things to sign, and then we're gonna probably pop off here, maybe like 9 minutes, 10 minutes. All right, let's try out this new signing orientation. Oh! No. I spilt. It's okay. It's gonna be okay, I say to myself. So here's this juicy sig. Hey, it's going good, Mr. Hudson. It's going well. How about yourself? Loving the content out on TikTok, sir. All right, Civity Doc. This is the new orientation for... That's pretty cool. I like that it's kind of like wisping up. Oh, thank you, brother, man. Thank you for dropping by. That's so sweet. I really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Yes, we do need to catch up. We should get a call going. Maybe a Zoom or a Discord or something. Just ping me. We'll get it on the books. Do we think this looks like a signature, or does it look like a drawing? What is a signature but a drawing that can get you in trouble? It looks good. I like it. Honestly, I really like it. It'll need to dry because it's juicy. It's juicy. Don't want to send it to Streamily Juicy. Beep, beep, beep. All right. Three more Dunmies. I'm going to do another green Dunmire. I'll do like two green Dunmires for folks. It looks good with the green. It's just he's such like a deeply serious character. such like a serially serious character that the green, it's metal, but it's like kind of undermines his seriousness. All right, I'll do the next one as a vertical. Did he get an email about this? No, I'm just kidding. Chris, what are you doing? People always sign it exactly same color, exactly same place. Hey, Bevan, thanks for dropping in, sir. We're just about to wrap up here. We got a few more signatures to do. Signing up these prints for our Lords of the Fallen fans. Beautiful umbral lamp design from Jewel DeQ from Powerhouse. Sorry, heard like a banging around out there in my hallway. But what's going on? What's the cat up to? Huh. We'll wrap up in a few here. We'll look into that. Mochi the cat getting into trouble. Let's do a copper one just to, well, let's not do copper. Let's throw it around. Ugh. Cool. What do you think of this 170 doc? We got that vertical going. Soined here. Vertical. I like that it feels like, yeah, like that, like smoke or something is whiff wafting up. Pretty cool. Put it on the pile. Yeah. All right, we'll do one more of each and then we'll be done for today. I appreciate everyone that joined the stream. This is my first signing, live signing that is, and I just really appreciate the support and interest in what I put forth. We've got some exciting characters and exciting projects coming out this year, so looking forward to seeing how people take all that in. Yeah, just really grateful for the feedback and support I've received. We got a Rogan done in the new. Granny Smith Green that chat voted on. Referencing that censored green blood from the Germany and Japan releases. All right, one more magician and one more. Hey everyone, I have just one more. Oh, is it two? Yeah. So two more Dunmires that we're gonna sign for backstock. You can get them off of the Streamily link in my bio. And we're also happy to just hang out. Gonna sign two more of these and then one more of the magician. And then we'll be done for today. We've been on for about an hour 15. I really appreciate everyone dropping in though and all the interest and support. You know, it's really humbling and I'm grateful for every ounce of, you know, every person that's interested in what I'm doing. So thank you guys. Uh-oh, a lot of extra paint on that. This one's gonna have to dry till next Christmas. It's really, I don't know if you can see, it's like a lot of extra paint on there. It's beautiful though. Oh, getting a little drip action. May have to table that one.
We have extras.
Let's do a silver Denmeyer. Let's do two silver Denmeyers just to have them. Yeah, I love this candy apple green. Candy apple green? I actually have never seen a candy apple this color. Like Granny Smith apple? Kelly green. That's another word for it. Really nice.
Just like that very realistic green blood from the game.
All right. Last one in the morning. Thank you guys again so much for dropping in. We will see you. Stay tuned for future signings. You're welcome to get anything that we signed on stream through the link. Yeah, if you see local cons near you that are asking for people you'd like to see and you want me to drop by, would love for you to put in my name. And I got some fun big characters coming out this year, some more to add to our collection. So thank you guys again so much for your support. It's been a fun morning, a little nerve-wracking, right? You know, putting yourself out there and inviting people into your process, but thank you guys for joining. Cool, let's do one last one. I keep instinctively shaking this pen like it's not already just so covered in paint. You just fix this. All right, let's get this good final one in here. Beautiful. Only had one spill. That's crazy. That's crazy good. This is the last one. Love you too, my friend. Thank you so much for dropping by. Your support is really felt, and I ain't fooling. Looking forward to seeing the next draft of your screenplay, sir. Thank you guys so much. This has been my first signing live on Instagram. We'll continue to refine the process and continue to expand the village as we go. Thank you guys again so much. You be well. You be safe out there. Have fun. And don't be a stranger. Bye.